Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam, Asher Kitchenu B'Matzvotav, Vitzvanu Lashok B'Devri Torah. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who sanctified us with his commands and commanded us to engross ourselves in the words of the Torah. Amen. We finished the background of Revelation chapter 1. We got into the epistles or the messengers to all seven churches, and then we started focusing on the first church. It is called Ephesus. Ephesus means darling or beloved. And the Lord is saying, with a name like Ephesus, why is it that you have become loveless? In short, he was saying, I have no problem with you from a doctrine point of view. Very essential from the church age point of view in today's context of 2012. Because the major problem in the body of Christ is doctrine. The major problem is doctrine. Man is the measure of all things. Sorry. Torah is the measure of all things. Take the Torah out. You have taken Yeshua out. You have taken the Ruach, the breath of God out. You have taken Elohim out. You cannot adopt a theory of man is the measure of all things. It's totally satanic. Seven is the number of God's completion. Three talks of his unity. And six is the number of man. Man can never be the measure of all things. And today, there are so many different assemblies that call themselves churches. And they are so varied in fashion, in dress, and in spirit, because they lack the basic foundation that is the Torah. 99% of the Western churches are flawed in their doctrine because they call the Torah the Old Testament. There's nothing old about the Torah. The Torah can never be changed because the Torah is Yeshua HaMashiach. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. It's a part of Elohim. And the Word became flesh. Huge problem for the Jews, especially the rabbis of today. They cannot accept that Yahweh Elohim became a man. Huge spiritual problem for them. Why? They're in a state of blindness. We who have the mind of Christ find it very easy to understand. So he's talking about this church and he's saying, listen, I understand everything that you stand for, which is doctrinally correct. But I have one charge. He says, I know your ideo, your works, which comes, as I said, from that Greek word ergon, which means energy. More than anything else, they had something that a lot of churches don't have today, hupomone, their patience. He said, and that you have bastazo, patience, right? The patience has borne the bastadio, the patience, and labored the capio, right? But don't forget protosagape. Protosagape is your first love. And believe you me, that is something that establishes bridges for life. Last week I got a call. I had to go and pray for somebody. Somebody who used to be here with us. For whatever reasons, they didn't come. And yesterday he calls me. I was at a meeting. And he says, you know, David, spiritually, I have you in my mind as the only person my family can depend on for prayer, for guidance, for whatever. He said, I cannot think of one pastor whom I can call at a time of difficulty because they are all running after money. And he says, you know, I feel so comfortable talking to you in such a span of time that nothing has changed. That, you know, your love for me, your care for my family has been as if we were with you yesterday. And I think that's the most important thing. Somebody could have been here with us, worshipping with us, not worshipping me, no, worshipping Adonai, for whatever reason, they might have gone out for whatever reason between them and God. But our job is to love them. Our job is to care for them. And especially to be there for them in their time of need. That is love. It's very easy to love each other here because we are one group. But it's when people go out and they have a difficulty. And I'm telling you, you will find that your difficulty is not inside here. Your difficulty is in the world because you're working in a man-made system. Sorry, Satan-made system. And that is where we must have this hupomone, right? Because you're going to face people, and I think my biggest problems from that same scenario, the Nicolaitans. A little knowledge in anything is dangerous. And there are a lot of people who've come here and learned a little bit and said, fine. Now we can go and start our own thing. It's not by might, it's not by power, it's by my ruach, says the Lord. My ruach. I cannot teach you. Take for example what I taught you last night. You mean to say that this cranium has so much of intellect to understand hyperspace, hyperdimensions? I can't. And I'm fooling myself if I even for one nanosecond believe that I can teach the word of Yahweh Elohim without his Ruach. Firstly, it's blasphemy. The second thing, it is the highest point of foolishness to know that I can live on this earth, practice whatever I'm practicing without that connection between God and man. Let me just tell you, as the Lord is leading me to talk to you about this, the day any one of you or anybody who disconnects that connection between God and man will face a Hebrew word called Kosek. Kosek is so thick in its darkness that you can really cut it with a knife or a scissor. That's the thickness. They did not know Yahweh. Kosek descends. And that is why there are a lot of people walking around and looking at their faces, you know that they're in Kosek, they're in spiritual darkness. And you will know those who are walking with the Lord because the light of Yeshua the Messiah is on them. Whatever, you know, you will find they will have a financial challenge or something. But they're talking about the Lord. How great is our God? But you will find those who are in Kosek complaining all the time. And more than the complaint, they have no solution. And that is primarily of somebody who has lost that connection, that divine connection between the Father and his children. You see, he says to those who believe, he calls them the Bene Ha Elohim. That's the same title given to the angels. And today we know that the angels move in a world of hyperdimensions, right? They are not bound by time and of a 10-dimensional world with 4 physical dimensions. They don't. They move in a hyperdimensional world. And they move with the Lord. See, a lot of people, because of this, as I said, stupid, heretical teachings of the Western Church, it's heretical that there is a book called the Old Testament. We have no idea, and I'm saying this very blatantly, people can challenge me on this, that the average Mr., Mrs., Miss Christian cannot explain Genesis chapter 1. If somebody can come and tell me this is Genesis chapter 1, I will shake their hands. Because I am telling you, Adam moved in a 10-dimensional spirit or more. If you look at the life of Yeshua, he worked in at least 10 to 14 dimensions. We cannot figure out our brain, which is three dimensional, and we have to contend with the fourth dimension. Ephesians chapter 3 clearly explains that to you, the four dimensions. We can't figure out the four dimensions, and we are trying to explain Genesis chapter 1. How can you? When the word of God says God walked with Adam, there are paintings of an old man with a long beard like Rip Van Winkle walking with two guys who are naked. Walking in Central Park. Adam moved in a dimension that we cannot even comprehend, because, again, another fallacy. People say we are made in the image of God. Yeah, sure, after you're born again. But until you come to that point, you're born in the image of Adam. You can't move in that dimension. That is why 2 Corinthians is so, 1 Corinthians 2 is so, so important, that we have the mind of Christ. You're moving back into that dimension of understanding the things of God. You see? But when you move in that, you cannot forget Protos Agape, your first love. Because love is the one, it's not a commodity, but it's the one gene element that makes us different from everybody else. The one gene element between you and the heathen is agape. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. It's so amazing. Just last night I was teaching on the breastplate, and Reuben, the color is red. Why? Because God gave his son as a red sacrifice, as a blood sacrifice, that your blood, which cannot be taken into that heavenly altar, can be substituted with his blood, divine blood, to make a way for you and me. Amen. The promise to the church of Ephesus, that he will be able to eat from the tree of life. Isn't it amazing that that's what God invited Adam to eat from, right from the start, to eat from the tree of life? He said, but of all the trees in the garden, there's one tree, don't eat from it. The tree of what?
Knowledge.
Knowledge. Remember, knowledge of good and evil. And that is why when man falls, God says, now that has man has become like one of us, knowing both good and evil. The danger is when you know what is good and what is evil, you start deciding what in your mindset appeals to you as good and appeals to you as evil. And then you're doing God's job. And then you're walking in the same footsteps of Isaiah chapter 14 and Ezekiel 28. And I'm telling you, a lot of people do not understand what impact the fall of Satan had on this universe. We can't even understand. There was so much destruction, which was the end product of the venting of God's anger. To me, it's very clear that Satan's seat was on earth. There are no two words about it. Because the word of God in Ezekiel 28 says, you were first seen, where? In Eden. In the garden of God. That garden doesn't exist today. You can dig as much as you want. You won't find it. But I'll tell you something. When the new Jerusalem comes down, you will walk in the garden of God. All those stones will be back. The word of God says in Revelation 21 that the walls will be like jasper. How can you imagine what jasper is like? And it says there will be fine gold, but you will be able to see through it. How can you see through it if you are not living in a hyperdimensional world? This is hyperdimensions they are talking about. How can you see it with a three-dimensional mind? You can't. That's why it says we will be like God. This body, this brain cannot comprehend the things God has for us. And he says here, that he will give those who were in the church of Ephesus as well as those who has the same attributes as the church of Ephesus, except that you do not lose protos agape, your first love, that you have the guarantee that you will eat from the tree of life. Amen. The threat, it says that God will remove your lampstand. Now what does this mean? That you lose your entitlement to the kingdom of God? No. You will lose your entitlement in working for the kingdom of God. We each have a mission. And he will take that lamp out. That anointing will move. Let's get on to the next church. Smyrna. Smyrna comes from a Greek word which is used in the word myrrh. Myrrh, when it's crushed, it gives out a sweet fragrance. And that is what this city is all about. The ancient city seems to be have taken from Legales by the Eleogian Greeks about 11,000 BC, and there still remains a trace of this Cyclopean masonry of that early time. In 688 BC, it passed into the possession of Ionian Greeks and was made one of the cities of the Ionian Confederacy, but in 627 BC, it was taken up by the Lydians. During the years of 301 to 281 BC, Licinius entirely rebuilt on the new site of the southwest of the earlier cities, surrounded by a wall, standing as it did upon a good harbor. So it's a very prosperous place. In Roman times, Smyrna was considered the most brilliant city of Asia. It is considered the place, right? Successfully rivaling Pergamus and Ephesus, and its streets were wide and paved, and a system of coinage of old, right? And now about the city of coins from every period are found. So it had a lot of financial prosperity and also a lot of political focus. It is celebrated for its schools of science, medicine, and for its handsome buildings. Among them was the Homerium for Smyrna. Homerium, H-O-M-E-R-I-U-M, Homerium for Smyrna, which was one of the several places claimed to be the birthplace of the poet, right? Homer. That's where you get this word Homerium, where the poet Homer came from. You know, the Iliad. On the slope of Mount Phagus, there was a theater which could seat 20,000 spectators. Just a theater for entertainment. In Sri Lanka, we don't have a theater that can hold 20,000 spectators. But there they had. So it was very prosperous. In AD 23, a temple was built to honor Tiberius and his mother Julia. And the golden street connecting the temple of Zeus and Sibylle is said to have been the best in the ancient city. Now this is where I want you to stop and think for a moment. If you do a study like what I have done about this demon goddess Sibylle, it will frighten you, because it starts right before that, from Babylon, from Semiramis, right, who was an Assyrian, and comes right through, takes that divinity of the mother of God, of the intercessor between God and man, right, and comes right down to today's modern Mary of the Catholic Church. Smyrna in early days became a Christian city, for it was one of the seven churches in the book of Revelation, chapter 2, verse 8 to 11. Rome honored, now here is something that a lot of people don't realize. Rome was full of rules. They were a very balanced empire. They had lots of rules. And they had one thing. If there was a religion that existed prior to the Roman Empire taking over, they honored it. That's going to happen with the one world government. Any established, registered religion under the one world order, providing you bow down to them, they will allow you to practice it. But the problem came up in Rome, that there was this new group of people who were not Judaizers, who were not worshippers of pagan Roman idols. They call themselves the people of the way. New religion. Blink, blink, blink. And knowing that, the Jewish people of that area, it was not the Sanhedrin, because that was anyhow collapsed in Jerusalem, but the Jewish priestly segment, or the people who govern the synagogues, went to the Roman authorities and said, here are people starting a new religion. They are not with us. Bang came the Roman edict, persecute them. That is how the early Christians suffered greatly in Smyrna. It's amazing, isn't it? It's also telling you how the church age was moving. That it was doctrinally sound. It started losing out because of his obnoxious Jewish attitude and culture in the church of Ephesus. And now the church was going through a period of persecution. Right? Rome honored all religions except the fact that once a year there was, in different parts of the Roman Empire, an altar erected to Caesar. And all you had to do was to come once a year to that altar, take some incense, put it down, puff of smoke goes, you bow down in the name of Caesar, and you get a certificate from the Roman governor saying that you are abiding by the law. And the Christians said, we can't do this because now we bow down to Yeshua. So two things: they became a new religion, they refused to bow down to Caesar, and they were in a Roman Empire. Do you know the things that happened to them? They couldn't trade because they were considered pariahs. They couldn't worship because they were a new religion. And moreover, the Judaizers said, these people are not Jews. You see, so there was a lot of persecution. Furthermore, there was the entrance of Sibyl, the mother goddess, introduced into the Roman culture from the Greek. She held the title of Magna Mater, mother of all mothers, queen of heaven. Now you understand how the Roman Catholics have embraced Sibyl in the form of another woman, Mariam of Nazareth. See the deception. Magna Carta, or the great mother of all the gods, plus mother of the earth, Gaia. Gaia. It's Gaia, right? Gaia is still one of the main terminologies used in the United Nations. Protecting Mother Earth, G-I-G-A, Gaia. Gaia. There's another name she had, Rhea. Okay, I know that there are different forms of Rhea that's in the marketplace today. But Rhea comes from that Roman goddess, Sibyl, who comes from the Greek. That's it. It's amazing. When you start seeing these things, they all tie up. When you see these names like Rhea or Gia, you know it has to do with Sibyl, the mother goddess. The one who connects, now listen to this, this was the dogma. If you worship Gia or Rhea or Sibyl, she is the one entity that connects the known world, earth, and the unknown worlds of the gods. So everybody started talking to her. What was, if you turn that into modern terminology, she became the intercessor between God and man. What is Mary today in the Catholic Church? The intercessor between Yeshua and the chosen people, Roman Catholics. They're chosen. There's no other church except the Roman Catholics. That is what they postulate. But it's blasphemy. Yeshua the Messiah says, Shaul writing to Timothy, there's one God. There's one mediator, the man Christ Yeshua. Where does Mary come in then? Sibyl. There's nothing new under the sun. Nothing new under the sun. Right? The thing that was is the thing that shall be, it shall be again. There's nothing new under the sun. In short, sheep represents the first female mediator between the earth and the people and the heavens, the gods. Surprisingly, this is the position that Rome and the co-god mother of all the gods, the mediator became the one who today is postulated by the Roman Catholic Church as Mary. Christianity was therefore considered a new cult, and the church faced persecution from both the Roman citizens, which is mainly the Roman armies and the governorship, and the Jews. Okay? Because they were preaching another gospel. It is there that Bishop Polycarp, who was in his 80s, was tied to a stake on the Shabbat and roasted because he refused to recant his position that he would burn incense to Caesar and that he would not attend synagogue, right, to hear the Torah. He said, no, we know the Torah, but now we have met the living Torah. And he was roasted at the stake. It seems that the Jews of Smyrna were the most antagonistic than were the Romans to the spirit of Christianity. If you take today, the people who are totally against people who are preaching the free word of God, as I said, the free word of God, big difference. Most people sell the word of God. You can listen to the word of God, but you have to tie it to us. You have to become a member to us. That means the word of God has a price. Here you come in here, you get the free word of God. That's what I'm trying to say. Most places, the word of God has to be purchased for a price. Right? You will find that the same thing is working. Today, the Roman Catholic Church is working so fast to smash down the free church as long as you pay allegiance to the Pope. Yeah. There's a video going around, right, on YouTube, which shows you huge American churches, evangelical churches, so-called born-again churches. And how is this whole process introduced? It says, Your Holiness, may I present the head pastor of the Evangelical Association of Churches in America. Your Holiness? I'm sorry. That is blasphemy. Only the Father is good, Yeshua says. Only the Father, Abba. He is Kadosh. He is separated. He is holy. And He alone has to be worshipped. Not my words, but the words of Yeshua the Messiah. He said, when Mark, who wrote Mark's Gospel, who wrote actually Peter's Gospel, when Mark, he's the rich young ruler, and he comes and says, Master, what is it, you know, that I must be good to inherit the kingdom of God? And he says, why do you call me good? Why? I mean, here's Yeshua, sinless, God in man. He said, why do you call me good? Only the Father is good. And here we have, back again, that Roman system. Again, Caesar worship, the Pope. Intercessor, the Matriarch. Sibyl, Mother Goddess. Nothing new under the sun. It's happening in our day. Right? So, it's just amazing that this is where Polycarp was burnt because he refused to bow down to Caesar. His grave is still shown in a cemetery and it's still there. And like many other cities of Asia Minor, Smyrna suffered frequently, especially during the years of 178 AD to 180 from earthquakes, and it was escaped, but it always escaped major destruction. During the Middle Ages, the city had many struggles and the most fierce was directed by Timu against the Christians. Tradition relates that there he built a tower using the stones as the heads of thousands of captives which he put to death. Yet Smyrna was the last of the Christian cities to hold out against the Mohammedans in 1424. Out of all the persecution, out of all the seven churches, the last church standing there was the church of Smyrna. Isn't that amazing? It lasted there till 1424 and it then fell into the hands of the Turks. It was the discovery of America and the resulting discovery of the sea route to India, which ruined the trade in Smyrna. Because then, instead of going to Smyrna, they started going into different directions. Revelation 2:8, the church of Smyrna. The church under persecution. The name symbolizes myrrh, sweet to smell, bitter to taste. Today, if you are a part of the free church, and as I said, let me redefine what the free church is. It means you have the right to worship in any congregation, but you have to be led by the Holy Spirit. You can go to a different congregation, when I say a different assembly, because they're all a part of Messiah. But you have to be very careful that they're doctrinally sound. That's where the Ephesus church comes in. You have to be doctrinally sound. And I'm telling you, the majority of churches are not doctrinally sound. If a church is celebrating Christmas, if a church still postulates a term called Easter, if a term postulates that the Shabbat has been changed from Saturday to Sunday, if the church postulates that there are two books instead of one, it is not a free church. In short, it's not moving free. If a church is insisting that your tithe has to come to them, insist, there's no freedom. Because then their dependency is the slavery on 10% as opposed to the God of Israel who gives you 100%. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord. Amen. They suffered from the onslaught of the Roman Empire's paganism, which is what the church is facing today. When I say church, the body of believers. Harassed by those who do not endorse it. This group would suffer martyrdom, while in the end period, a group such as this would also go through a process of a literal 10-day period. That's why the Lord says, I know some of you will be cast into prison for 10 days. Now, I just want to take you into a different realm. In Hebrew, it says, there's a thing called the remes, which means there's a deeper thought behind it. If you look at the remes of this, you will find that 10 Roman emperors persecuted the Christians. It's amazing. So the 10 can allude to 10 different Roman emperors, but also because you were not bowing down to Caesar, that you would be thrown into prison for 10 days, right? Very similar to the Jewish Holocaust or the Shoah. The promise to them that will be very similar to that of Stephanos. Stephanos means crown of glory. The word Stephan, we have it in our English Bibles as Stephen, but his name is Stephanos, which means crown of glory. And he's the first Gentile to give his life up to the Lord. Right? It's amazing that they threw stones at Stephen because they said he blasphemed. And it's the only time in the Word of God it's recorded that Yeshua, son of my right hand, Benjamin, is seen standing up in heaven to receive Stephen. It's amazing that they threw rocks. It's amazing that the same rocks that is alluded in Stephen's martyrdom is what Satan offers Christ and says, turn this into bread. It's amazing. You see? The promise that he who is martyred, the overcomer, will not be hurt by the second death in the lake of fire. Revelation 14, 9 to 11. Revelation 19, 20, 2013 to 15, and 21:8. Those who go through suffering in some form of persecution is given the guarantee that they will never face the lake of fire, which is called the second death. Right. So as I said, God is true and faithful. That's his name according to what he's saying. And there's only a very little we learn about the church of Smyrna. But what we have to take from that is a few facets which I'd like to focus on. The people in Smyrna were the smallest group in that very prosperous city because of their fervor, because of their conscience, of what was right, what was scripturally sound. They were persecuted, they were killed, they were not allowed to do certain jobs. Most of the prestige jobs were not given to them because they were not considered as Roman citizens. Right? But with all of that, it says that it was the church that lasted right to the end. What did it tell you? That their dependency was not the material empire of Rome, but the spiritual empire of Yeshua. Why is it that in the book of James, or Yaakov, that's his Hebrew name, it says, brethren, consider it a pure joy when you are going through tribulation? What a statement! Consider it a pure joy when you are going through trials and tribulation. Remember this, the word of God also says, whom he loves, he reproves. Whom he loves, he reproves. No diamond comes out of the ground as a polished diamond. A diamond comes out as a rough stone and is put to the ferris wheel, which cuts it, it polishes it, sparks come out of it, causing it to be cut and molded and faceted in the hands of one who is the diamond cutter. Church of Smyrna was in the hands of Yeshua the Messiah, and they were being fashioned as the jewelry that he would put on a crown called the crown of glory, Stephanos. And that's our challenge for you. Whatever trials I went through last week, only Sudarshini knows the major part of the pressure that I went through. But where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord. He says, joy comes in the morning. And I'm telling you, yesterday I had two very important meetings. And all I got from both those meetings was favor, favor, favor. Yes, we have to undergo a lot of persecution for what we believe in, for what we stand for. But it's worth it in the end. Because out of that persecution, the Lord uses that to polish us, and we come out shining because we get dull after a while. Take the best piece of jewelry. You need to polish it from time to time for it to sparkle. And when a trial comes in future, let me encourage you, like the Church of Smyrna, allow that trial, because it has been foreordained, it has been permitted, with one simple reason: you will come out of that trial shining brighter, because you are that crown of glory, Stephanos. Shall we pray? Father, we want to give you thanks. We want to give you praise, Lord, for everything, Lord, that you have taught us yesterday and today. Thank you, Lord, that a part of our walk is persecution, because Lord, you said that you were persecuted first by the world for what you stood, for what you said. Lord, today the Jews in New York, Jews in Israel, say that you are a Christian Messiah, you're not a Jewish Messiah. How sad. Lord, we pray for the Jews in Israel, that spiritual blindness may be taken off their eyes, and Lord, that they will come to know you the way we worship you. Father, this is how you instructed Aaron to bless the children. Ivarekaka Adonai Vishmareka, Ye Adonai Panivileka Vihunuleka, Isa Adonai Panivileka Yeshemleka Shalom. The Lord bless you and the Lord will keep you. The Lord will make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord will lift up his countenance and give you his shalom. Go in the peace and in the blood protection of the Messiah of Nazareth. In Yeshua HaMashiach's name, I proclaim this over you. Amen and amen.